to the last discussion. 20 minutes. So I'll just summarize. So we finished about relationships.
150.
And just come to
150.
Yeah, 150. Okay. 150. Okay. Yeah. So now we go to. Okay, and just about the ego. One of the biggest things which comes in relationships is the ego of not wanting to step down. And if the ego is not there, then 1 plus 1 makes 11. Otherwise it becomes, it's just a contradiction. So we had two similar parties. One was Krishna and Arjuna. Krishna had no ego. He was a prince. He was the builder of Dwarka, married to 16,108 queens, famous throughout the world. And he was becoming the chariot driver of Arjuna. No ego, absolutely. His introduction of the Gita is first as a chariot driver. And a chariot driver is a very menial task, because while the archer is fighting, he has no time to speak, because he's chanting the mantras for the arrows, and he has to kick the chariot driver in which direction to move, or certain languages conveyed through kicks. And it is his responsibility to protect the life of the driver. First, the opponents used to try to kill the horses and kill the chariot driver. And the chariot driver has no weapons. He's fully dependent on the archer. Such faith, such a bond has to be there. Imagine. Have you ever done this exercise where you let yourself go and the person behind you is famous exercise? Such a faith is required. And that was Krishna. And on the other hand, so Krishna and Arjuna had a wonderful combination. Arjuna used to tell Krishna something, Krishna used to agree. Krishna used to tell Arjuna something, Arjuna used to agree. On the 11th day when Karna came to fight, at that time Karna, he started giving excuses. He said, "I don't have a good enough chariot driver, otherwise I would have defeated Arjuna like this." And Duryodhan turns and looks at Shalya. Now Shalya is a king, but he's an expert chariot driver. He says, "Shalya, can you be the chariot?" Shalya says, "What do you mean? Come on, I'm a king. I'm as good a fighter as Karna." And Karna says, "You're not as good as me. Be my chariot driver and you'll get some credit at least." So it starts with and Duryodhan is saying, "Shalya, please, you know, Karna is very powerful. Please, if you become this chariot driver," he's saying, "he can win." And that day, Shalya agrees to become the chariot driver. But both these are so opposite. Krishna and Arjuna start off with, "Arjuna, let's plan this way today. Yes, Krishna, what do you think?" And here, Shalya begins by saying, "Yesterday you used all the wrong weapons. You could have killed more people." Karna is saying, "You shut up, you're the chariot driver. You do your task, I'll do mine." And Karna is saying, "Go left." And he's saying, "No, there are too many people. Let's go right." And now these two chariots face each other. And Arjuna and Krishna, and Shalya and Karna. And the whole thing is about Karna is saying, now in the as the fight goes, is the day when Karna is facing Arjuna. One of the times when Karna puts his arrow behind, the snake, one of the snakes who is wanting to take revenge on Arjuna for burning the forest, he comes into his armor and he takes out the arrow. And when Karna puts it here, the snake whispers in his ear, "I'm a very special weapon. And let me tell you what to do. You aim me straight at Arjuna's neck. There is no way I can miss." At that point, Shalya is listening. And Shalya says, "Karna, don't aim at his neck." Oh, sorry, he's saying aim at his forehead. And Karna is saying, "Don't aim at his forehead, Shalya is saying, "Aim at his neck." And then Karna is saying, "Why?" He's saying, "Because you see what Krishna will do. Somehow he will stop the weapon. Use it. Aim at his neck." And Karna is saying, "No. I am such a flawless archer. Wherever I aim once, it will hit." And then he pulls back the arrow, aims it at his forehead. And Krishna understands which weapon is coming from that side. And so Krishna presses the chariot down. Presses it down and hits his crown. And the crown just bursts into. And Arjuna asks, "What was that?" Then Krishna, there's a little story comes. It's quite interesting. In the middle of the fight, they're telling stories to each other. Krishna, here there's a death and life and death is going on here, and there are stories. And Krishna tells the brief history that this snake does that. But the snake was so intelligent, he comes back into the quiver of Karna. And again, when Karna goes behind, he comes into his hand and puts him again, he whispers, "Aim again." And Karna says, "No. Because of his ego, he said, I can't aim a weapon twice. He wanted to set a standard. I am such an archer, I don't use a weapon twice." And Shalya listens again. Shalya says, "You fool, this is not a time for ego. Shoot, now you will kill him. Now Krishna won't do it again. Shoot at his forehead, shoot." And Karna now gets even more instigated. Who are you to tell me? You are a chariot driver. You just do your task. And then such a heated argument starts taking place, and then Shalya starts saying, I curse you, you will die today. Imagine the two people who are supposed to be together, and Karna saying, I curse you, you will also die in this battle and you will also lose everything. And this is, and on the other side is Krishna and Arjuna. Krishna saying, Arjuna is saying, Krishna, thank you. No, it was anyway, it was, you know, it was your doing, you are such a good archer. Such a beautiful, and now, then, and as we know, later what happens is Karna is going to be defeated. So just because of ego, the whole thing went wrong. A very similar story, same two cases, two childhood friends. Krishna Sudama versus Drupad and Drona. Very similar situation. Krishna a prince, Sudama a brahmana. Drupad a king, Dronacharya a brahmana. Childhood sets off for both equally well. Both go to the same Gurukul, both the parties. Both have very good friendship, very deep relationship. Krishna tells Sudama when he is going finally one day. They are leaving. Krishna says, if ever in your life you need anything, I am the king. Please come. Please, I will be more than happy to help you, save you. Please come and meet me. And Sudama parts. And same thing, Dronacharya, Drupad, very good friends, very thick friends. At the end of their Gurukul days, Drupad tells Dronacharya, I am a king. You are my dearest friend. You are a brahmana. If ever you need anything, please come to my palace. I will help you. And few years later, Sudama one day sitting in his home, and his wife tells him, do you remember Krishna? And then he starts speaking all the stories of Krishna, how he was, how he used to steal butter, how he danced on Kalya. And then Sudama's wife tells him, for the sake of our children, she knew if she tells him for your sake, he'll never go because he's a selfless brahmana. He says, for the sake of your children, we have nothing to eat. See, their clothes are tattered. Please go. Go and meet your friend Krishna. And Sudama is still feeling, how can I go and ask for something? Then she says, okay, at least go and meet him because he asked you to. Make him happy. And she knew Krishna will give him something if he goes. Then Sudama says, okay, please give me something. Do you have something for me to take? And she has hardly anything, but she has some chipped rice, some very old poha. She wraps it in his wrapper and like this. And he takes it around and he starts walking. For 9 days, he walks towards Dwarka. All the while, he's feeling the thorns and everything is hitting him, but he feels nothing. Because when the mind is absorbed in something, have you all ever had such a good mathematical problem where you forget your lunch? Or is that a bad example? Have you all had such a good, exciting movie where you forget lunch or you forget dinner or you forget? That means the mind has the power to transcend bodily pains. The mind, when controlled, when tasyaham nigraham manye, he's saying, Krishna is saying, if you control your mind, it is the controlled mind is your best friend. Uncontrolled mind is your worst enemy. If you simply learn to control your mind, you can transcend, just like you can transcend bodily pain, you can transcend the other pains also, because the mind is under your control. That is what holds it. There is one famous Australian teacher who teaches you, and anybody can go and do this. You can walk on coal, burning hot pieces of coal. Have you seen that? I was seeing this. Amazing. He just trains you for 5 minutes. You have to just think of something else, and you can see these people are walking on those live charcoals. Nothing is happening. That is the power of the mind. It's defeating science. You are supposed to get burnt. Nothing is happening. Just because you tune your mind to one channel, it'll only hold that channel, won't think of anything else. So Sudama, absorbed in the memory of Krishna, he's walking, 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 and blood is coming. He is absolutely absorbed. And when will I meet Krishna? When will I see him again? How he was, my dear friend, my good friend, comes to the door. The gatekeeper stops him. Who are you? Where have you come from? And he gets scared. He said, I'm Sudama, I've come to meet Krishna. Meet Krishna? Now Krishna, from his Gurukul days, now he has come to Dwarka with 16,108 palaces. Huge! The palaces made of gold with coral walls and silver, and the streets were paved with diamonds, and there were diamond markets. In fact, in Madurai, when the British came, it took them 17 times the army had to go to try to loot. Not Madurai, one temple. 17 times till the army could not finish its loot. And in Madurai, there were markets. Like people sit with vegetables, they used to sit with diamonds. That was the prosperity of the country at that time. So Sudama comes in and he's stunned by seeing this opulence of Krishna's palaces. And all the more he's feeling embarrassed. He said, will you recognize me? When a person becomes very opulent, when he becomes very high, then he forgets small people. What will you think of me? And from inside now, the gates are closed and he's standing here, and suddenly he starts hearing horse and he's hearing people coming and soldiers walking, and he's thinking, oh God, they're coming to throw me out. Why did I say I know Krishna? Should I run? And the gates burst open. And Krishna is running ahead, and his ministers, his empty chariot, they are saying, sit on the chariot at least. But his eagerness to meet his friend is so much, he's running ahead. He's saying, Sudama! And then Sudama first time sees the warrior Krishna in his beautiful crown and his chest with marks of various weapons, because now he's a fighter, he's a warrior, and his beautiful dark complexion and his hair blowing in the wind and perfectly effulgent face and that smile, and Sudama, tears coming from his eyes, and he reaches out his hands and he embraces Sudama, and everyone is wondering there, who is this poor man, and who is he going with Krishna, and what is this? And Krishna takes him inside the palace and makes him sit on his bed where Rukmini used to sit, and he calls Lakshmi, the goddess of fortune, come and wash his feet. And Rukmini and Krishna, because they are bleeding, they are putting water. And there's a very beautiful painting of this scene where Sudama is sitting on the bed and tears are coming from his eyes, seeing the love of Krishna. And Krishna is sitting down, looking at him, washing his feet. And then Krishna feeds him. Then finally, after a few days, that day he takes the poha from him and chipped rice. And Sudama is saying, don't eat it. He's serving Sudama on golden plates with so many delicacies and wonderful things to eat. And Sudama gave him chipped rice. And when he eats this chipped rice once, twice, and he's about to take it a third time, Rukmini stops him. He says, that's enough. You've already, in those two bites, you've given him more than he can ever dream of. Enough. And then Krishna says, this is the most beautiful thing which I've ever tasted. The most tasty thing. Why do you think Krishna said that? Was it really tasty?
It's pure.
What is the meaning of pure?
Love.
It's love. One day, little girl woke up her father. She was 6 years old. She woke up her father. Father, father. In the early morning, he says, what happened? Papa, happy birthday. And she took out a $6 pen and she gave it to him. And he took this pen and touched it to his heart and looked at it. Very simple and not even the best pen, but he was so touched. And he hugged her. He said, thank you so much. How did you know it's my birthday? What was that father appreciating? What did he really, did he like the pen? No, he could have bought $100, much more pen. And who gave her the money to buy the pen? He gave the money. But what Krishna wants is, he has given the resources, he has given the idea, everything. He just wants us to choose him. He just wants us that, the fact that that girl took the time to take that money, buy the pen and choose to give it to her father, that is what touched the father the most. And that is what touched Krishna, that he came. This chip price did not represent the rice, it represented his love, it represented his friendship, his giving himself to me. And so Krishna tastes it, and when Sudama goes back, there's a huge kingdom flourishing, everything waiting. And that's one part of the story, one story. And on the other side, a few years later, Dronacharya, he comes back. His wife tells him, go, Drupada was your same situation. He thinks, will he recognize me, will he remember me? Anyway, he's a very just king, very generous king, he'll surely give me something at least. And Drupada comes, same situation. And now Dronacharya comes. Drupada is sitting in this country where he's the king. Power, fame, prestige. And at the gate it is announced, Dronacharya the Brahmana has come to meet you. He says he's your childhood friend. This is spoken in the public assembly. And to Drupada it becomes an insult. He says, my queens, all the ministers, if they know I went to Gurukul with such a low, with such a apparently low class person, he's a Brahmana, but you know, they may think I didn't go to Harvard, they'll just think I went to, you know, some, how could such boys join my college? And he says, I don't recognize him. And the guards go back and they tell Dronacharya, he doesn't recognize you. And Dronacharya says, tell him I'm Dronacharya's childhood friend. 2-3 times they come and go, sir, he doesn't recognize you. He says, then Dronacharya understands what's going on. He says, okay, tell him a Brahmana has come to beg charity. A king can't deny charity. Then they go back and tell him Brahmana has come to beg charity. Then he feels, yeah, I can't deny. He says, okay, come in front. And now in front of the whole court, Dronacharya is standing there. And Drupada, with guilt in his eyes, he's seeing. And he says, yes, dear Brahmana, who are you? Where have you come from? And then Dronacharya smiles. He said, my dear king, you forgot all the days we spent in Gurukul. Which Gurukul are you talking about? I don't remember anything. Do you want some charity? Take it and go your way. And then Dronacharya says, no, I don't want any charity. You promised me that when I come, you will give me whatever I want. You aren't going to give me. In fact, you told me you will give me half your kingdom. And he said, I don't remember what this man is talking. Please hear, dear citizens, where has he come from? He needs some charity. Give him as much gold and cows as he wants and send him away. And then with that vengeance, so it built with a little ego, and now Dronacharya's ego got pricked. And he goes back and he decides that day, the goal of my life is to see Drupada down, to see him equaled. So I have to do something now. And then he's wandering in the forest. Now he's taking that vengeance in his heart, goes to the forest one day, and he sees these boys playing in the field. The ball of these boys has fallen in the well. And he goes to the well, and boys are all looking what to do. And he takes straws, empowers them with mantra, and throws them one into the other, into the other, into the other, and pulls the ball out and gives them the ball. And they say, what was that? He said, oh, that was the beginning of, you know, archery begins with darts. So I was just playing darts. They said, if you play darts so well, what must be your archery skills? Are you a teacher? He says, yes, I have a Gurukul, I will teach all. And then they come into the Gurukul, teaches them for years with the one vengeance in his heart. When these boys are well trained, I will ask for some Guru Dakshina. And finally, that training is over, everything is done, and all the Kauravas, Pandavas finally say, what is the Guru Dakshina you want? Yes, this is the day I was waiting for. There is a king called Drupad. All of you go attack him and bring him, bind him like an animal and throw him at my feet. And he knew that these are children, they have just passed out of Gurukul, but they are special children, they can do it. And first the Kauravas try, unfortunately. 100 of them go and they are defeated. Drupada completely routs their army, sends them back. And then he turns to Arjuna. He says, Arjuna, you 5 brothers go. I know you can defeat him and bring him back here. And the 5 Pandavas attacked for the first time. And when Drupad faces Arjuna in battle for the first time, that time he feels he is a fitting. If I ever had a daughter, it would have been for this man. And that's how his first desire comes out. That this is the kind of prince. If I had him as a son-in-law, then that would be someone. And the second desire which immediately comes in his heart is, I know I'm going to get defeated today. And if I ever have a son, I will produce him to kill Dronacharya. And that day Drupad is defeated, bound like an animal, thrown at the feet of Dronacharya. And then Dronacharya says, now you are my servant. I am the king. I will not forget. You forgot. I will not forget. I give you half your kingdom back in charity. So now we are equal. And that doesn't end there. Now Drupad's ego has grown. He goes back to his kingdom, does the yagya. For months this yagya goes on with one objective, to produce a son who will kill Dronacharya. And then comes out Drishtadyumna, comes out Draupadi. And then Drishtadyumna finally in the end, in the war, both Drupad is killed and Dronacharya is killed. Same friendship starting in the same situation. Little ego or little image or something got pricked, and where it ended up. We've had this simple story in college, school days, in childhood we used to learn that 2 goats come on the bridge and neither is ready to bow down, and both hit each other and both fall. Another 2 goats come and one goat says, okay, I'll bow down, and you walk over me, and he gets up and both go their way. So from this story, this Stephen Covey got his other formula, think win-win. How when you come in any situation, never think lose-win. Always think win-win. Worst is lose-lose. People who don't want, like he's saying, pluck my one eye out, my neighbor's 2 eyes will pop out. Lose-lose. But think win-win. Okay, I compromise a little bit. How do you compromise a little bit? And both of us can get ahead. Both of us can think win-win. So that was about the ego. Yes. And let's come to contribution and corruption. Yes. And that was... It is said that when the king is selfless, if you read Yudhishthir's description of his kingdom, it is so amazing. He was such a good king, nature paid tax to the king. When the king is so good, it is said that without scuba divers going into the ocean, pearls used to come onto the surface. Without any mining, gold and silver was on the surface. The seasons were perfect, not too hot, not too cold. Day and night struck at the 3 sandhyas were perfect. There was no thunder, no lightning, no excessive rain, no excessive heat and cold. The fields, when ploughed, they used to give much more produce than... In fact, this is recorded in British Times, that there is some recent statistic I was reading. a 10 hectare field is supposed to produce, I'm forgetting the numbers, but something like this, it is today producing 100 units. In British times, it was producing 1000 units. That was the fertility of the ground. So in Yudhishthira's times, they used to plant something and it just give 10 times more result, 20 times more result. That was the prosperity. In fact, if you read in Ramayan, the kings were so prosperous when in Janak's kingdom, there is a drought. For 11 years, there is drought. Not a drop of rain has fallen for 11 years, but nobody understands why. Because the stock of grains lasted 11 years for the whole kingdom. After 11 years, 12th year is also the final backup. Then they understand, oh, something's wrong. Oh, rain didn't fall for 11 years. That was their prosperity. So here it is described, because of Yudhishthira's selflessness, when the king is so selfless, mother has to cooperate. When the child wants to help, because the mother is there, mother is for everyone. And one of the children is doing so much for the mother, then the mother produces. It is said that the cow can give milk or it can give blood. If you slaughter the cow, then it will give blood, which is of no use, which will spoil everything. And if you love the cow gives milk. Same way, if you slaughter Mother Earth, if you exploit Mother Earth, then she'll withdraw all her resources, which is happening today. Ground has lost its fertility. All the seasons, I'm here in New York for 8 months, and which season, morning it is rainy season, and afternoon it is summer season, night it is winter season. What the havoc. According to Ayurveda, the body is being badly damaged by this climatical change. The body can't sustain 10 degree shift, more than 10 degree, the body gets ruined. That's why all our immunity systems, here I heard peanut allergy, pollen allergy, this allergy and that allergy, because the body is so shaken by the environment, it loses all its vitality, it loses its durability. So in his time, it is said everything was perfect. Nature paid tax to the king. There are these shlokas which they recite and then say nature paid tax to king. And this happened, nature paid tax to the king. That was his selflessness. And on the other side, there was Duryodhan's overburden of taxation. When Indraprastha is built, Duryodhan actually closes one of the gates. Because citizens start leaving and joining Indraprastha. He said, you're not allowed to go. This route is blocked. Stay here only. And they're saying, no, we want to go. Same thing when Ram gets banished, they say, we want to go and we live in the forest. We'll make a new kingdom in the forest. So his is the overburden of tax. And we see two characters who are absolutely selfless or absolutely selfish. And one is selfless and service. I'm taking it a little together. One is Bhishma on one side and one is Shakuni. One of the most enigmatic and beautiful characters of the Mahabharata is Bhishma. From his birth, he is just an embodiment of self. He lived only for what can I serve. It starts with him being born, Devavrat. Flowers are falling from the sky, predictions that he will Ichha Mrityu, he will do this, he will be the backbone of the Kuru dynasty, he will protect you for six generations, he will oversee, he will fight with the gods, he will bring down the greatest of prosperity in his rule, nothing, so many predictions. And his life starts with him one day going off to the bank of the river, and when he comes back, he suddenly notices his father is very sad. And keeps asking, father, what happened? Father, what happened? And they are the signs of someone in love. So he understands, father, are you in love with someone? And father says, no. He says, no, tell me, you are. He says, yes, but I don't want her. Because the Shantanu fell in love with Satyavati. And Satyavati's father tells him, if you want my daughter, Satyavati's father is a business minded, if you want my daughter, her son should become the king. But Shantanu, being a very wise king, understands the king has to be Bhishma, has to be Devavrata. Nobody can, such a son who will produce, he has to sit on the throne. I will let go of my, so he's ready to let go of the pain of, okay, not having the love of his life for the duty towards his kingdom. That the best king has to, best man on the throne, I can compromise. But Devavrata on his side, he wants to be selfless towards his father and saying, something is troubling you, tell me what happened, what happened. Finally reveals a little bit of the secret and Devavrata goes to try to search. And he understands, okay, my father had gone to such and such place yesterday. He reaches the land of the place where Satyavati is there and she is very beautiful, immediately understands that yes. Now, in just a little off point, one may wonder that these kings seem to be really lusty. Anywhere they go, fall in love with anyone, take anyone, you know, what is going on here? But just see, when Shantanu falls in love with Satyavati, Satyavati comes back to the father and the fisherman challenges Shantanu. He says, first of all, you're a Kshatriya. How can you fall in love with this girl? She's not at your level. You have to fall with intelligence. Don't fall for skin beauty. Fall for something deeper. Shantanu says, I am so pure. I am so wise and knowledgeable. I have lived my life with such integrity. If my heart goes on someone, it is divine will. Mm-hmm. And now that is, both are confused. And then Vyasadeva comes and tells Satyavati, yes, from you, great sons are going to be born. And the story of how you came, you do belong to a Kshatriya family. And that is why his heart could be captured by you. So all the kings, when they moved about, they already knew the histories of these princes. Like when Drupada is deciding, this is whom I want for my prince, he has already heard a lot about Arjuna. What are his qualities? What is the lineage he is coming from? What character he is? So it was never a skin attraction. And that is why it lasted. That is why it was beautiful. It was perfectly compatible. If it's just a skin attraction, then it is going to finish in no time. So Devavrat reaches here, and Satyavati's father tells him, yes, he wants her hand, but he can't get it unless her son becomes the king. And Devavrat, without thinking a moment, he says, I give you my guarantee. I am the son of Shantanu, the firstborn, the heir to the throne. I relinquish the throne. I will not sit on the throne. And that's his first vow. I will never sit on the throne ever. I'll never be the king. But the father is a little skeptical. He says, but what if you do get married and then you have children? Then you're the firstborn. Then your child will sit on the throne. Maybe now her child, but after then your child will claim. And then he takes a second vow. I now vow that I will never get married. I'll remain a celibate for the rest of my life. And that time, flowers fall from the sky and they say, Bhishma, Bhishma, Bhishma. And the meaning of Bhishma is one with a terrible vow. Why did they say terrible vow? Because he's a person who's going to be in the middle of a kingdom, surrounded by wealth, opulence, power, politics. His own personality is so powerful and charming. How will he avoid not getting married? How will he avoid it? And then they say Bhishma. And for the rest of his life, it's not that Bhishma does not suffer from temptation. Bhishma does not suffer from two thoughts. But his selflessness keeps him going. No, this is what I've decided. This is what I'm going to do. And later, when Satyavati tells him, finally when Vichitravirya dies, everything is over. Now nobody's there to sit on the throne. She tells, you sit on the throne. He says, no. I took a vow once. I can't do it. Why? Two things can come up at the same time. If from one angle, it could have been a wrong move. If he had sat on the throne, it's over. Then everything would have worked out. Maybe we don't know where Mahabharata would have gone. But why the Kshatriyas were so strict on their vows? Because they wanted their citizens to believe in their character. Only then the citizens will selflessly serve you. They fully trust you like a loving father. So once spoken, when a Kshatriya is to say something, they should know it's done. We know in Dwarka, when that Brahmana comes and tells Arjuna that my 9 children died and you are the king. Nonsense, I don't trust you anymore. He takes a vow. I vow, I'll save your 10th child, otherwise I will commit suicide. Then the Brahmana sleeps peacefully. And that day, the child dies. But that is a different story of Krishna wanting, then they go to Mahavishnu. But that is why the kings used to take such powerful vows. And Bhishma, for the rest of his life, he is only a object of scorn from both sides. Because he has to be the advisor. Because when Shantanu left, he tells him, don't worry, I will make sure that finally a dharmic king sits on the throne. And that is going to happen five generations later. And he has to live all that time in that politics. And both sides blaming him. Some saying, you never sat on the throne. Some saying, why did you take the vow? And now he took the vow and Ambika curses him. I will be the cause of your death. Parshuram fights him and says, you're too good. You can choose Ichchamrityu. He's getting blessings on one side, curses on one side. But it's only for remaining selfless. Only for service. Only for helping others. Only for doing something for, let me do something for the world. And on the other hand, we have Shakuni, the brother of Gandhari, coming from Gandhar. And his whole life is about being selfish. He is the one, that's why this trio of Shakuni, Dushasan, and who were quoted here, Skanda, Karna, Shakuni, Stasya, Sakha, Dushasan, of Pushpaphale. These three, Karna, Shakuni, and Dushasan, ruined Duryodhan. Whatever little intelligence he may have had, that was stolen by these three. And primarily Shakuni, who plans the game of dice, who plans the disrobing. In fact, before, when the game of dice happens, it happens twice. In the first game of dice is when the disrobing happens. At that time, the Kauravas, the Pandavas are putting one by one, they're putting stick, everything. Finally, they put themselves. And then Shakuni says, play more. And Duryodhan asks, what is left? Then he says, Draupadi is on stick. Put Draupadi on stick. He tells Yudhishthir. And Yudhishthir says, okay, I put Draupadi on stick. Plays, Draupadi loses. And Dushasan's minister goes inside and says, Draupadi, you are being summoned at the courtroom. And then she says that, no, I'm not properly dressed yet. And in this assembly, I'm not supposed to go. I'm the queen, not required. He says, I'm sorry, my queen, you are no longer the queen. You have lost your choice. You have to come. And then that's the first. She doesn't know what has happened just outside. She's sitting peacefully. And then she agrees to come. And when she enters this assembly, everyone is jeering and cheering, and they're like wolves waiting to devour this beautiful lady. And she comes in the middle. And then the situation first is explained by Shakuni. He says, my dear Draupadi, this is what happened. And your powerful five husbands, see, they are like cowards sitting there. They can't do anything. They have lost whatever they had, and they have put you on stake. Then Draupadi puts a golden question in the assembly. She says, whom do I belong to? If my husbands have lost themselves, do they have the right to put me at stake? And this becomes a, even though it was an assembly of, every time dharma is being questioned, she says, if it is my dharma, I'm lost, I'm ready to do what you want. But it is, I think it's not, I'm not lost, because the property of the husband always remains the husband. And if he lost himself first, how can he put me at stake? And this question starts with Bhishma, and Bhishma is totally confused, and he tries to think. He says, according to dharma, I think that the wife can be put at stake. Drona says she can't. Somebody, everyone is saying something. Vidura, he says, to hell with your dharma. If you do anything to this lady, that is the end of the Kuru dynasty. He is one who speaks strongly. And finally, Shakuni says, she is a prostitute now. Because anyway, she had five husbands. So what if she gets some more? Dushasan, strip her naked. And then Dushasan first holds her cloth. Then Bhima gets up and takes the first vow. He said, I will, Draupadi, I take a vow today. I will crush his heart, and I will make you bathe. You will stand on his skull and bathe your hair with his blood, because he has touched it. When he takes this vow, now this is a Kshatriya's vow, and it's Bhima's vow. It is going to happen. Dhritarashtra gets so scared. First he says, stop. At that time now, but the passion in the assembly has picked up so much. Duryodhan then puts his dhoti up and pats his thigh. He says, Draupadi, come and sit. And Bhima takes his second vow. I will split your thigh into 1,000 pieces and kill you on the battlefield. And now, second time, Dhritarashtra says, stop. But the passion is so much, all the brothers start laughing. They say, yes, strip her naked, let us see her beauty. And then Bhima takes the third vow. I will kill all the 100 brothers before I die, and I will put their blood on the battlefield. Then Dhritarashtra finally understands what's happening. He says, stop! Stop this! Draupadi, I as the king forgive everything. Pandavas, you get the kingdom back. You get whatever you put at stake back. Draupadi, you can go back. And then Dushasan, who's now starting to pull her chadar, he's pulling. And Draupadi, now this is another scene from the bhakti angle. If you see it from the bhakti angle, why was it that Bhishma did not get up? None of the Pandavas got up. Nobody got up. They could have. There itself, they could have destroyed everything. Because in this particular scene, it was Krishna who wanted to show that my devotee will never perish. Shipram bhavati dharmatma, shashvat shanti nigachati, kaunte pratijani na me bhakta pranachati. He says, I guarantee. Now, Draupadi begins to first, she turns to her husband. She said, you cowards, what are you doing? Look at me, I'm lost. And Bhima is ready to pounce, Arjuna is ready to pounce, but Yudhishthir, he holds them. And he's thinking, what is dharma? He's confused. Can I fight or can I not fight? What is to be done in this situation? And these are some places where Yudhishthir is really even criticized by everyone. How could he do this in this situation? Vidura is shouting, but he can't do anything. He's bound. Bhishma, Drona, they're not getting up. So she's turning one by one. She turns to Vidura. Vidura shouts at Dhritarashtra. She turns to Bhishma. And to each one of them, she's reminding which lineage you come from. This was the glory of the characters. They are reminded about their responsibility. It is said that to whom much is given, much is expected. Even when Krishna wanted to incite Arjuna to fight, he doesn't call him, he calls him Kaunteya. saying that which dynasty do you come from? Remember your forefathers, what all they've done. You want to be a scar on your family? You want to be a black patch on your family name? So much was the responsibility a person felt. I have been born in such a great lineage. I have to do my duty. That is what made people do walk the right path. So she's reminding everyone, Bhishma, your father is this. This is what you did. This is what you were promised. This is what you have become. You're not going to do anything. And he looks down. Dronacharya, this. You're not going to. Finally, nobody is doing anything. She holds her own sari. And she is not. She has no strength against Dushasan, who was also as powerful as 10,000 elephants. And finally, when nothing works, then she puts up both her hands. And now the scene at Dwarka is very different. Dwarka, Krishna is playing chess with Rukmini. And as he's playing chess, suddenly he stands up. Rukmini says, what happened? He says, my devotee is in trouble. Rukmini says, go and save her. And he says, no, she's asking her husbands for help. Okay, they'll help her, and sits down, plays again. Again he stands up. And then again Rukmini says, go and save her. He says, I'm waiting, but she's asking Bhishma for help. Again he sits down. Again he stands up. But she's using her own strength. Again he sits, and then finally, when she puts both her hands up, she says, hey Krishna, hey Raghava, hey Sakheti. She's calling out, Krishna, you come. And then Krishna leaves. There are beautiful songs in this scene. There it is said that for the first time, Krishna looked at his chariot too slow. Garuda, too slow. And he himself flew. He said, both are too slow. And the speeds, and Garuda's, the chariot speed is described as lightning, and Garuda's speed is described as fast as the mind. But Krishna's heart to save his devotees so much, I don't need these two. I myself am going to go. And he appears immediately in the assembly scene as an unlimited sari. Starts coming in, and more she pulls, and then it's nothing. So these characters, from the bhakti point of view, they are all pure devotees. They understand how they are playing a role. And in this scene, Krishna is going to be the hero. So they don't want to step in. If Bhima suddenly said, I'll kill everyone, finishes everything, and then Krishna will say, my scene was there, what you... suddenly if the, you know, some actor somebody goes into the set. So here they understand, yes, Krishna is definitely going to save Draupadi, and that's why they don't do it. So Bhishma, yeah, that is how, yeah, this is what coming into Bhishma's scene. And in service, we also see on the other side how there is motivated service by Duryodhan. When Shalya's regiment is about to arrive, Duryodhan says, I know how to win his heart. I'll give such hospitality that he'll say, I will come on your side. So Duryodhan incognito arranged